you guys wanted more. So here are 11 unexpected behaviors and hard to find features. Number 1. Renaming and deleting nodes in inherited scenes can cause problems. Godot's scene inheritance is an unbelievably useful feature. You can easily take a base scene and adapt it. This also works so well with script inheritance. But there is a problem we came across. When you manipulate a property of a node in the inherited scene and later remove or rename it in the base scene, you will get an annoying warning like this. It does not directly cause any harm, but you don't want warnings in your project if you can prevent it. The inherited scene still has the reference to the deleted node, but we cannot remove the reference anymore. The simplest solution we found is to reset the properties before removing or renaming the node. You can also edit the scene file in a text editor to fix it.
Number 2. Color values can be greater than 1. The modulate values of canvas items can be put above 100%, but only if you switch to RAW mode. It's not accessible in RGB mode. This is very helpful if you are working with HDR enabled. You can easily make stuff glow or make it glow but still translucent, combined with transparency. Thanks Ranjan and Divan for pointing it out.
Number 3. Using global position and rotation. Every node 2D and node 3D has a position and rotation you can access. These are always relative to their parent's position. The actual position in the world is the global position. It can be read and changed like usual. The overall rotation is stored in global rotation. So, if you want to set two objects to the same position, it is usually wise to use global positions when they do not have the same parent.
Number 4. How to use enums. Enums are very helpful in Godot. You can access them anywhere when you give the script they are defined in a class name. You can set a specific value or let them increment automatically. Apart from that, it behaves like a normal dictionary. You can get the keys with .keys and the values with .values, which is nice.
Number 5. Curved textures exist. Godot has curved textures and they are neat. You can edit them with the curve editor, but they get sampled into a texture. With this, you can easily pass curves to a shader and describe any property you want. We made an example on how to use a curve to describe the path of a particle using a particle shader.
Number 6. Particle systems can spawn in local and global coordinates. Particle systems give you a choice to spawn the particles in local or global space. This changes whether the particles move with the particle system or independently. It can look really cool to spawn them in global space, but be aware, global space particles are no longer affected by the scale of their particle system node. However, the particle velocity and other properties are affected for whatever reason.
Number 7. How to use viewports. You can imagine a viewport as an extra canvas to draw on. They can be helpful for shader effects and split screen. Everything within a viewport is drawn on that extra canvas. It can be accessed as a texture, for example by a sprite, a texture rect, or as the parameter of a shader. If you want to make split screen, add the camera to the viewport and set the world of the new camera to the world of your main camera.
Number 8. You can save default import options. Often when you import resources to your game, you want similar parameters. In a pixel game, filter is usually turned off. There is this little hidden option menu that allows you to set presets. This is Mini told us about this feature. Thank you!
Number 9. They are helpful built-in constants. Using them makes your code more readable and performant. For vectors, there's vector 0 and vector right, for example. For transformations, matrix identity and transform identity are your friends. Also, pi is defined. For colors, there's a wide array, but the ones we use most frequently are color transparent, color white and color black. These are especially helpful when fading out objects using tweens.
Number 10. The ways to stop nodes. There are different ways to deactivate a node. You can set process to false to disable the process loop, but the node will stay visible. If you call hide or set visible to false, it will keep on acting invisibly. Also, you can remove it from the scene tree. That will pause and hide the node until it is re-added. Finally, if you call Q3, it's gone. In case you want to pause the whole game, use getTree paused equals true. You can allow specific nodes to keep working by setting their pause mode to process. Keep in mind that even in a paused game, the time variable for shaders still increases. This can be changed by setting visual server set shader timescale to 0.
Number 11. How to use tool scripts. Tool scripts are witchcraft. You can write tool in any script to make it run in the editor. When a script changes nodes, the changes will happen in your project. This can break some stuff, so be careful. However, if you are brave, they can be your best friend. Here's an example where we sampled points from a path 2D into a line 2D to draw the path in the game.
So there's one more thing we want you to know. We make devlogs where we explain how we make our bouncy 2D action roguelite Furcifer's Fungeon. We also make silly jokes, so go check it out. And also check out the first 10 things if you haven't yet. Subscribe if you like this, and thanks for watching.